It headed for the rose garden, almost as though it was being guided there. And then it found the figure of the golden witch and fluttered down. So we're pretty much saying that Kinzo's a pawn of Beatrice at this point. We also can say, since she's palling around with Maria, Maria's in collusion, Maria's an accomplice to whoever the Beatrice is. And she pretty much is in every fucking scenario, in every episode. Episode 1, Maria was an accomplice. Episode 2, Maria was an accomplice. Episode 3, Maria seems to be an accomplice again. So, I mean, small wonder, right? She's talking about witches and shit the whole time. So that can't be a surprise to you guys. But yeah, she's an accomplice of the actual witch who's doing the killings in all three games. If you didn't know. When it came right down in front of Beatrice, it burst open and returned to its original form, flying through the air. The way it was going, you would have expected it to fall into a puddle, but it stopped suddenly in midair, almost as if some transparent person had caught it. Apparently, even Beatrice hadn't expected this. However, she realized that no, who it was, and grinned broadly at it. It's from Kinzo! As she did, the shadow of the person who had caught the ring began to fuzzily appear. This is the guy we saw in that opening, right? Oh, I know who this is. Wait a minute. We know who this is, guys, right? If you watched Irumakun, we know who that is. Okay, I thought I had the fucking song. I guess not. Hold on. I know where it is. Hold on. Where it is. It's on my downloads. Oh, I've got to go online. Give me a second, guys. I could have swore I had it. Alright, we got it. What the fuck, man? So I had this song downloaded. Somehow it didn't fucking stay on my hard drive. Or I just can't find it wherever the fuck it is. Oh well. Anyway, we'll figure out who this guy is real quick, and then we'll play the song. So who's this guy? There was no man like this among the servants of the Usuramiya family. Even so, Beatrice laughed as though it was someone she remembered fondly. So he caught the ring right before it came into Beatrice's hand. He intercepted the ring. Ronove? We got a new character here. His name is Ronove. Let's see if he's on the fucking list. I don't see him on the list. Alright, well. Since it's the Purgatory and all the goats. Don't see Ronove. Alright, not yet.
Kono Rono. Ojo-sama ni otsukai shiteiru koto wo wasureta Hina to tada no ichinichi mo gozaimasen yo. それよりもお嬢様にこそ私をお忘れになられたのではない。何しろお嬢様は大層お忘れっぽくていらっしゃいますので。
なるほど、確かにわらわは忘れやすいよ。そなたの皮肉を聞くまで思い出せぬとはな。
お嬢様、これを。
With an exaggerated yet elegant gesture, he bowed respectfully and held out to Beatrice the head's ring that he just got.
Usuramiya Kinzo yori henkan saremashita. Usuramiya ke toshu no yubiwa de gozaimasu. Yubiwa wa futatabi aruji no moto.
Kinzo niyoru game no kaishi sen.確かに受け取ったぞ。
さて、今宵はどのようなお遊びになさいましょうか。
You want the stash on or off? I want it on, Monov! Too bad!
早速、ルーレットをご用意いたしましょうか。それとも、まずは紅茶をご用意いたしましょうか。
どちらにしようか迷うが、とあやつめ、開いた口が塞がらぬというような顔をしているに違いないぞ。
Talking about Bachelor!
なあ、バトラ
ー。はじめまして、自己紹介をいたします。ベアトリーチェお嬢様のおそばにてお使いしております。どうぞ。よろしくお願い申し上げますよ。
ほらな、開いた口が塞がらないという顔であろう。
当たり前だろ。またこんなわけのわかんないやつが出てきやがった。ヤギアタナが盆踊りを始めるのかとぼやいた。
ヤギアタナが
いよいよ現れて、太もも姉ちゃんたちが7人も出てきて、その上今度は羊まで出てきやがった。わけわかんねえよ。もういい加減にしやがれよ。
ところでバトラー、こやつとそなたの対面だが、これが本当の悪魔の
悪魔の証明。どういう意味だよ。
こやつはこう見えても72柱に名を連ねる木、つまりわらわ悪魔を直接連れてきて、まさにその存在を証明してみせたわけだ。ロノエは地獄に爵位を持つ序列27位の大悪魔よ。なかなかに使える男でな、高級で召し上げてわらわの世話をさせておるのだ。
ご紹介いただけまして光栄です。地獄の貴族に名を連ねと、今は卑しい人間の分際って 悪魔も裸足で逃げ出すような大魔女であられるベアトリーチェ様の家具柱として使える身ですよ。
実に使える男なのだが、何しろ口の減らぬやつでな。
I just gave you a clue, by the way, that Beatrice used to be a human back in the day.
時に主への敬いを忘れるのだ。たまに気づ
く。言葉遣いに関しましては、契約書から漏れておりましたものって。そのように契約を変更いたしますか。
わらわも退屈せぬからそれでいい。
Beatrice turned her back to him, cackling. After bowing once to her back, Ronov turned back to Battler and stuck out his right hand, showing off an innocent smile. Normally, this would mean that he was asking for a handshake.
何の真似だよ。
私もお嬢様のわがままに振り回されている身です。その意味では私たちは良き友人になれるかと思いますよ。これは友情の握手です。もちろん悪魔の契約の締結を意味するものではありませんので、ご安心。
悪いが、俺はあんたの主と大喧嘩の真っ最中でね。俺が敵と握手をするのは、雨の皇帝でぶちのめし合って互いがボロボロになってかわす青春ドラマみたいなシチュエーションの時だけさ。覚えておきな。
なるほど。マトラ様と握手を交わすには十分な雰囲気作りとふさわしい場、そして心に響く甘い言葉と肉体言語の交わし合いが必要。機会を見てその場を準備いたしましょう。
Remember that?
私にもそういうシチュエーションは大好きでございますよ。
As Ronovi laughed hauntingly, he whispered to Battler, bringing his face so close that his noses were almost touching. Battler's face turning red after standing so close to another of the same sex pushing him away.
気色悪い野郎だぜ。なるほど、ネアとの執事にぴったりのやつだ。
お褒めの言葉を賜りまして、こう、私は紅茶には自信がございますので、ティータイムを楽しみにしていらしてくださいね。クッキーを焼くのが趣味でございますので、お茶菓子にもこうご期待をお願いいたします。
さすがは同性同士だな。
は、
焼けるぞ。
これはこれは、お嬢様に嫉妬させてしまい申し訳ございませんでした。お嬢様のお客人をこっそりつまみ食いなどいたしませんよ。それではこれより他の家具どもに再び家具柱に着任いたしましたことを挨拶してまいります。しばしの暇をお許しください。
権限しているのは雑用のヤギどもと儀式役の七姉妹だけだ。挨拶も楽に終わろう。
おや、あのにぎやかな七姉妹たちですか。やんちゃ娘たちも少しはおしとやかに成長したでしょうか。
あれがおしとやかだってんなら、俺はおしとやかな定義だぜ。
そうでございます。七姉妹どもとはもうお遊びになられたようですね。その表情から察するに、どうやら相変わらずのやんちゃぶりのようだ。メアトリーチェ様にお仕えするにふさわしい振る舞いをするようにといつも言っているのに、困った子たちだ。
その意味でなら安心しろよ。実に主にぴったりなふさわしい振る舞いだぜ。
しかし 会話は相手を認めるということ。わらわとの雑談に応じるようになったということは、そなたがわらわの存在を徐々に認め始めている。
That's kind of true.
たとえお天道様が西から昇ることがあろうとも、絶対の絶対絶対、お前泣いて俺の靴にキスしたら、もうちょい前向きに検討してやってもいいぜ。
Even if Badler was bluffing, he still spoke forcefully, a fierce expression on his face. Winch and her butler snickered together, revealing that their guests had gained more than enough of his willpower to attend a new game. That preparations were complete. After Rono exchanged a few words with Beatrice, he bowed slightly at Badler, scattering into several gold butterflies and disappeared.
Wow!
Let's see if he's there now. Hold up. Let's see. He's there. Ronova! He's got a theme song, guys. Here it is. Hope I don't get copyright striked for playing this. Ronove Romier! From, Welcome to Demon School Itermakun Season 2, guys. New character name Ronove. Same name as this guy. Es un nombre tan fabuloso que hasta que quiero. Si, Don Mormia.El levantador de disciplina de Babilis vino a tomar el consejo de Timo. I can't read the fucking Spanish subtitles fast enough. Here's a song. Amore! Enhorabuena! Kita!
Ti amo!
My name is Ronove! 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 Edison! Ole! That's Ronove's theme song, guys. Love it. One of the 72 great demons works for a master in exchange for various forms of compensation. He currently has a contract with Beatrice as a butler, head furniture. He's become a proficient at housekeeping after serving in many households, so his ability as a butler is very high. In the high society of witches, of witchcraft, and high society of witches, employing him has become a kind of status symbol. Furthermore,The cookies he's baking are superb. You smell what the rock is cooking over here? And witches will often form a line demanding them. He must possess tremendous magical power. But since he always stays out of the spotlight to further boost his master's reputation, his combat capabilities are unknown. So he's probably a beast at combat skills. That's all we got from Ronove.Is there anything different about this? Let me see. Thus, bullying the weak and is capable of using trial and error endlessly to find the cureless fate that can possibly be given. He tells the victims even further, piling on. Okay. It's about the same. It's a little different, though. Word has it that she sometimes becomes obsessed with creating certain patterns. We've heard that before. So, only new person here is Ronove. Ronove, Romiere-san!
Olé!
にぎやかになるのは実に嬉しいこと。この島にたった一人閉じ込められ、己の力を取り戻せず誰に話しかけることもできない
。あの気持ち悪いやつがお前に似合いの執事だってことはよく分かった。だが教えろ、その執事がなぜ今頃になって現れた。
Good question. This is episode 3. Why have we just now seen him?
権限しているのはヤギと七クイの姉ちゃんたちとかなんとか言ったな。どういう意味だ。
そなたは抗っておるな。わらは魔界に通じ人ならざる数多の存在と交流を持っておる。
だろうな。お前の関係にはろくな連中がいねえぜ。ヤギの化け物に太もも姉ちゃんに、そして今度は悪魔の執事が来たわけだ。まさかとは思うが、この調子でまだおかしな連中が増えるってんじゃねえだろうな。
Well, he said it.
わらわの荘厳なる黄金館に仕える家具どもと、そこへ遊びに来る悪魔たちがどれほどいると思っているのか。まだまだ訪れるぞ。いくらでも現れるぞ。黄金鏡の扉を開き、すべての家具たちを呼び戻し、そして懐かしき友人たちすべてを招き、三日三晩を飲み明かし踊り明かしてやるつもりよ。無論金蔵の一族たちも招くつもりでいるぞ。望めばそなたもな。
つまりこういう、お前は長いこと力を失っていたためそいつらを呼び出せなかったと。それで徐々に魔力が回復してきたため、そう言いたいわけか。
そういうことだ。そなたは最後の一戦でこそギリギリ踏みとどまっているが、その心はすでにぐらつき、わらわが魔女であることを否定できずにいる。その心のぐらつきがわらわの魔女としての力を少しずつよみがえらせているのだ。
あの気色悪い執事が現れたのは俺が屈しかけているからだというのかよ。
そうだ。そなたは少しずつ少しずつ、前回のゲームではあれほどの屈辱を受けてまでわらわに屈服したではないか。そなたの背中はわらわの足を投げ出すには本当に良いものだったぞ。
ちり、ちくしょう。俺はお前を認めさえしなければ現状は維持できると思っていた。だがそれはどうやら誤解だったらしいな。
そうだ。そなたが屈服に近づけば近づくほどゲームはわらわに有利に傾いていく。チェスだってそうであろう。互いのキングを詰め合う過程でわらわたちは様々な駒を取り合っている。確かにわらわは未だそなたのキングを追い詰めてはおらぬ。しかしそなたはキングを逃すのに精一杯で、いくつもの大駒を失い、後の展開がわらわに有利に傾くのは当然のことよ。
オブジェクション。
くそ。
そなたはおそらくこれからも死に物狂いでわらわのチェックメイトだけからは逃れるだろう。だがその間にもわらわはそなたの大駒を次々に奪っていく。 やがてはキング以外の全てを失い、どのような形でも逃れることのかなわぬ本当のチェックメイトを受けることになろう。前回そなたは機嫌を吐いたな。わらわを永遠に認めぬ以上、これはわらわを苛む永遠の拷問だなどと。
Talking all that shit.
永遠を語るのは無限の域に達した魔女だけよ。そなたにその資格など初めからないわ。
Smoke that ring. Valor just got a dressing down by a witch. You'll be alright. It's still the first night, don't worry. We'll see who the first six are though, pretty soon.
黄金の隠し場所については、すでに金蔵様が私の肖像画の下に碑文にて公示されております。条件は、碑文を読むことができる者すべてに公平に。黄金を暴けたなら、私はすべてをお返しするでしょう。それではどうか今宵を金蔵様との知恵比べにて存分にお楽しみくださいませ。
It's a letter that Beatrice gave to Maria. Same letter that happened in episode 2.
今宵が知的かつ優雅な夜になるよう心よりお祈りいたしております。黄金のベアトリーチ。
When Maria finished reading the letter that Beatrice had handed her, everyone was at a loss for words a while. And then they all broke into silence at once.
バカバカしい、取るに足らない悪質ないたずらです。
まったくだ。親父殿が当主の指輪を手放すなど、ベアトリーチ。その名を語れば右往左往するだろうという見えすぎたいたずらだ。
おいおい、このちょいとパンチの効きすぎたデザートを仕込んだのは誰なんだ。今なら喝采で褒めてやるから正直に白状しろよ。ローザか。
とんでもない。お父様の名を語るいたずらなんてしません。
じゃあ姉貴か兄貴か。
私？兄さんでしょ。こういう悪趣味な仕掛けは
愚弄する気か。私こそお前たちに問いたい。このたちの悪いいたずらは誰の仕業なんだ。
Kraus beat the table and stared at everyone. Since that included the children, sure, he scared most of them.
お父様から財産の全権を任せられたと称するナッツ、そして今日がそれを話し合うための親族会議であることを考えると、いたずらだと決めつけるのも早計だと思う。
わからんで。まさにお父さんの悪趣味ないたずらかもしれん。自分抜きで遺産分配の話をまとめようとしているわしらをちょいと驚かせたくて仕組んだことかもしれん。
こいつを仕組んだのが親父だってね。アリアちゃんが読み上げた内容は冗談ってわけにはならねえぞ。
そうね、文面通りに解釈するならこれはお父様からのテストね。魔女の碑文は私たち誰にでも解けるようにずっと広間に掲示されていた。告示期間は十分。最初に解けた人間に家督と全ての財産を渡すと、そう言っているわけよね。
See? My magic granted your wish.
そんなバカな話はありません。
That was young Eva, by the way.
後宮家の次期当主が夫であることは何ら揺るがない事実です。それを揺るがすのがこの手紙じゃない。この手紙はお父様に財産の全てを全権委任された人物からのメッセージなのよ。もはや兄さんの当主継承権は白紙に戻ったわ。 魔女の秘文を解いた者が、ベアトリーチェの黄金を見つけた者が、後ろ宮家の次の当主になるのよ。
バカバカしい。その手紙のザレ言を信用するのかね。その風浪が本物だとでも信用などできるものか。
ならお父様に直接話を聞いてみましょうよ。もう機嫌が悪いからとか体調が悪いとかそんな次元じゃないわよ。この手紙はお父様の代理人であることを風浪でちゃんと示してる。それを疑うなら兄さんが証明しなさいよ。この手紙がお父様の意思のものではないって。
よかろ
う、right.
お前の言う通りだ。もう親父の機嫌不機嫌の問題ではない。上へ行き直接問いただそうじゃないか。
そうしようぜ。親父に直接聞こう。
親父も親父だぜ。
どうして、まそこが親父らしいんだがな。
お父様の手紙だということを前提に話を続けてもいいのかしら。
バカローザ！
ダン！
お父様の手紙に決まってんでしょ。あの手紙はお父様のなのよ。次期当主を私たち4人の中から選ぶための公平なチャンスに決まってるじゃない。バカ、死ね、この役立たず。
Yeah, say it like that, but damn. You're right.
ほんと、
Rosa needs to fucking woman up here. Fucking get her fucking piece of pie here. She over here, it's not fucking father. Shut the fuck up. Take Krause's power.Because, this is the only chance you're gonna get. You, Eva, and Rudolph. You only get this one shot. You only get one shot. Do not miss your chance to blow. This opportunity happens once in a lifetime, ho! This is, young Eva again. Rosa, you're really dumb.
Heso de mo kangi shinjai ba?
Gomenasai. So yo ne?
But do something, girl. You were all gung-ho last episode. What happened in episode 3? Where's your fucking shotgun at, right? What the hell happened? Get your Winchester. In the beginning, the adults had all doubted the credibility of the letter, but after realizing that this was once-in-a-lifetime chance and the inherited struggle for the three younger siblings, Eva changed her position, claiming that the letter was authentic.Rudolph and Rosa caught on in greed. There we go. Smart.
まったく、そんなくだらないいたずらを大の大人がこれほどまで真に受けるとは。
They got the fucking seal.
お父様でなくても呆れたい気持ちよくわかります。
まあ、ナツシさん、それはお父さんに聞けば済む話じゃないか。お父さんがその手紙は知らんって一言言ってくれれば済む話やで。
兄さん、責任を持ってその手紙は知らないという一言を引き出すのよ。機嫌が悪そうだからってビビってる場合じゃないんだからね。
いい年してお父様が怖いなんてバカみたい。
バカみたい。
へそかんで死んじゃえば。
That's your favorite saying, isn't it? Gotta give up and die.
You're going to do it, Krause. Sour Krause. Eat my dessert, bitch.
Eat my dessert, bitch. The four siblings, Natsu, Hideyoshi, all rose from their seats forcibly and flew out into the hallway with a clatter. I'm Kirie. Afterwards, only the children stunned, completely speechless, Nanjo, who looked uncomfortable, and me, Kirie, who just shrugged, were left.
Mm.
middle of all this was Maria, who looked a little scared at the Bill's sudden change. However, judging from her appearance, she didn't look like she realized the full meaning of what she had just read.
Itai, nani goto datten da yo? Wake wakannei ze.
They're all bastards.
こいつもクソったるだ。そんな兄さんが欲しいかい？
They do.
みんな。
We're greedy little bitches.
これは親たちの問題なんだ。僕たちには関係ない。
It's stating the obvious, George.
だから気にしちゃダメだ。
Didn't you already make a fucking promise about, oh, we're gonna like believe in our friendship? Fuck, gotta say that shit for, dude. Who fucking died and left you leader? Fucking George.
ああもうあからさまに。
見損なったぜ。欲の皮が突っ立ってやがる。
うん。みんなで幸せになるって信
じられない
とダメ。
そうだね。
Hey, you forgot that, George? What the fuck's wrong with you, dude?
僕たちはみんなで約束したもんね。ほら、バトラ君もジェシカちゃんも。
最悪の気分だぜ。
We couldn't accept it at all, but we laid down our arms for the time being. We've been vaguely aware of how filthy this family conference is going to be. However, after that 6-year blank, I couldn't help being shocked.It's useless. It's all useless. When he saw that the children were completely dejected, Dr. Nanjo cleared his throat uncomfortably. Ahem, let me clear my throat.
大人の話です。お若い皆さんとは関係のないことですよ。忘れてしまいましょう。
それができれやってるぜ。
辛いのはわかるわ。
That's what she said.
でも今は忘れてあげて。あなたたちの将来を少しでも豊かにするため、みんなの両親は必死で戦ってるの。
I'm sure I'm sure.
そしてやがて傷つき帰ってくるお父さんたちをどうかそんな冷たい目で迎えないであげて。
いくらキリエさんの頼みでもそれは難しいぜ。
そう割り切れるなら子供なんてやってねえぜ。
Exactly.
うわー、みんな幸せ。暗くなるのため信じて。みんなで幸せになれるって信じないと幸せが逃げちゃう。みんなで信じないとダメなの。
いい話ね。私も信じるわ。私たちは幸せになれるわよ。
うん、キリエおばさん、ありがとう。バトラとジェシカお姉ちゃんも信じて。ベアトリーチも信じないと魔法が力を持たないっていつも言ってる。
Kirie-san rose from her seat quietly, went over to Maria, and crouched down so that their eyes met.
Oh. あと、バトラとジェシカお姉ちゃんが信じないとダメ。
二人とも強いもの。すぐに元気になって、そうしてくれるわよ。
うん。
それより、教えてほしいの。
And Kirie-san said that Jessica, George, Aniki, Dr. Nanjo, and I listened closely. Okay, that's badly talking, my bad. Like our parents were so concerned with the inheritance problem that grandfather filled their minds, but we wanted to ask Maria something simpler.
Nani?
Maria-chan ni sono tegami o watashita no te dare?
Beatrice.
肖像画に描かれている魔女の。
うん、パサ と一緒にこの手紙もくれたの。そしてね、マリアのバラが折れちゃってたのを魔法で直してくれたの。ベアトリーチェは何でもできるすごい魔女なの。
詳しく聞かせてくれるかしら。
There you go. Smartest person in the room. We're at 8 o'clock p.m. Day one. I'm not sure who this is. Without even being allowed to wait for dessert, we were chased out of the room. I heard that in the end, our parents were unable to get Grandfather to respond. Well, I hate to say it, but I feel like giving Grandfather a high five right now. He's probably pretty satisfied with how a strange letter had given his children a good shock, since they had all been so infatuated with the inheritance problem while Grandfather's still alive. I also felt like despicable parents had gotten what they deserved in all this confusion. But I couldn't really say that I was feeling great. I felt all sulky. Apparently Grandfather hadn't seemed concerned with the whole thing, but he hadn't also denied anything about the letter either. Talking about the witch's letter, Grandfather's name kept popping up. Grandfather knew that someone was stealing his name, and considering his character, he'd probably be mad with rage. But even though Grandfather now knew the contents of that letter, he coldly ignored it. So did that count as a silent yes? Probably. Aunt Ava and Dad were trying to interpret that letter in their favor, their greed clearly visible. Wouldn't have mattered so much as if that was all, but the adults had now started focusing on Maria, who had received the letter. They kept pounding her with questions about who had given it to her. Maria repeated over and over that she had gotten it from Beatrice, but there is no way such a mysterious person could have sneaked onto the island. After all, this island is small, and there's no one living on it outside the Ushermia family household. Maria kept repeating that she got it from Beatrice no matter how many times she was asked. They all seemed to think she was trying to trick them, so they didn't hold back and questioned her until she broke out into tears. When Maria was released, she sobbed, all worn out from crying. After our parents ordered us to get to the guest house and take Maria with us, they shut themselves up in the dining hall and started getting louder and louder as they discussed the inheritance. It seemed that because of all that strange letter, Uncle Krause's chances of becoming the next head might have been reduced to a blank slate, and in exchange for accepting him, my dad and the rest were trying to swindle Uncle Krause out of a lot of money, or something like that. Disgusted as we were, Jessica and I were happy to move over to the guest house. We didn't want to be under the same roof as those filthy adults, their heads so filled with thoughts about money. George Aniki pleaded on our parents' behalf, saying that he wanted us to understand them. I understood his reasoning. No matter how filthy this talk of money was, it wouldn't go away if you just closed your eyes to it. Even so, how could they sink so low as to overtly fight over the money of the dead? Maria had cried herself dry and was hiding in her bed. She hadn't even twitched for a while, so she was probably sleeping.
Maria-chan は一体誰にあの手紙をもらったんだろうね。
ジョージ兄さん、マリアがベアトリーチェにもらったって言うならそれでいいじゃねえかよ。
It's obvious somebody dresses Beatrice. I mean, I don't know how these people can't get that.I keep asking her, oh, who is it really? It's not Beatrice, but who is it really? It's somebody dressed as Beatrice, is cosplaying as Beatrice. Duh, that's it. They specifically dressed as Beatrice to give her the letter. Duh. They can't think that. They can't think two steps ahead, probably. And George is just as stupid.
Maria を泣かせたくないしな。
Even though he said that, we couldn't clear away a gloomy feeling.
この島には今18人しかいないんだよ。そこにこの雨の中、未知の19人目がマリアちゃんに手紙を託して、今もどこかに隠れているというのは、正直現実的ではないね。
Shouldn't give it away, but yeah, it's somebody cosplaying. Somebody pretending to be Beatrice. Like, duh. Nobody was on the boat. Nobody was on the plane. Nobody was hiding in the fucking... as a stowaway. No, it was somebody in this island dressed up as fucking Beatrice giving Maria a letter. That's what it was. Who was it? I'm not going to tell you. And it was somebody, though. Somebody you've met.
Osoraku, ano shouzouga no dress wo Shannon atari ni demo kite moratte, umaku Maria to kuchiura wo awaseta tte koto ja nee no kana. Mottomo Maria no baai, ano dress wo mita ra sore dake de Beatrice da to shinjichimai sou da kedo na.
Dare ga watashita ka nante, dou demo ii mondai kamoshirenai na.大事なのは差出人だろう。要は、じい様が黄金の魔女の名を語って、人波乱を起こしたかったってことなんだぜ。まったく、人騒がせなじじいだぜ。
Most likely answer is that our cult-loving grandfather was playing around, handing the letter over to Maria, who shares the same hobby as he does in such a dramatic way. Though he failed to give any thought for what Maria would have go through, making it a pretty shitty thing to do.
Well,
it's definitely not grandfather. Like, how is she going to confuse grandfather from Beatrice? That's not going to happen.
手紙を渡したのが誰でもいいさ。マリアがベアトリーチェにもらったって言うんだから。
Exactly.
そういうことにしてやろうぜ。
同感だよ。そうしよう。
Are you fucking copycat?
子供にとってのサンタクロースみたいな存在が、マリアちゃんにとってはベアトリーチェなんだろうね。
It's like your father is.
いない19人目もサンタクロースも
Or Santa Yoshi
俺たちが認めてやればそれは少なくともマリアの中ではいるということになるわけだなるほど子供の夢を守るための嘘って大事だな
うんふん
どうしたんだよジェシカまだ腹を立ててるのかよ
Jessica had her hand on her chin as though there was something she couldn't understand. When I called out to her, she came to her senses.
Ah, gomen. Iya sa, Maria ga atta no wa, hontou ni Beatrice datta tte koto ga aru n janai kana.
Sorya dou iu imi da yo? Kono shima ni 19 nin me no ningen ga iru tte iitai no ka?
Maria chan no iu koto wo kokoro kara shinjita nara,そういう答えに行き着くだろうね。
いや、そういうのじゃなくて。昔からこの島には、私たちの知らない誰かが住んでるんじゃないかって話はあったんだよな。
That's still 19th person though, right? Either way.
住んでるって、どこに?
森の中にさ。
The adults were gathering in the dining hall, spending a very long time continuing the discussion that had been started by Beatrice's letter. Krause strongly claimed that the letter was a simple prank, but he couldn't overturn the claim that Kinzel's failure to deny the letter was answer enough. Judging by Kinzel's character, if he knew that that letter had been written in his name, he would be mad with rage. Since all the siblings knew that, Krause had no choice but to withdraw his claim. Uh-oh.Krause losing face. No, I even having to summarize that the contents of the letter were simple. The person who could solve the witch's epitaph would receive their headship and assets. This did a lot to damage Krause, who had been sure that he would receive the headship, and was better news than the rest of them, who had already given up, could hope for. However, there were some points that worried them. The person who solved the epitaph was not limited to a member of the Ushuramiya family.Taking literally anyone, no matter how doubtful of their origin, might receive the headship. And furthermore, this meant that this was a chance that all the Ushuramiya family's assets would be stolen by some unknown person. In that sense, it was definitely not a situation where even the other siblings could afford to lower their guard. Had this letter come from an assassin sent by Kinzo, calling themselves Beatrice? Or was this the scheme of some unknown person trying to steal the Ushuramiya family's wealth? They still didn't know the truth. But they could say one thing for certain. Maria had received this problematic letter today on this island. In other words, someone planning something to do with that letter was on this island today. Had it been said by Kinzo, one of the four siblings, or maybe some unknown person, no matter how much they suspected each other, they couldn't reach a conclusion. After getting tired of bickering with each other, they finally reached the extremely obvious conclusion that doubting each other was just a waste of time. There we go. After a couple of hours of wasted time, right? They finally figured that out.
Nachi ga akan ne. Muda na jikan wo tsuiyashita mono da yo.
Sou ne. Niisan ga kizuite kureru dake de kore ijou wo rouhi shinakute sumu wa. Tegami no sashidashinin ga otousan kaiwa no naritatanai anata ni shujin ga akire hateta dake desu.会話が成り立たないのはどっちよ。私が何か言うたびにあなたは怒鳴ってばかり。そんな無様で後ろ宮家にふさわしいと本気でお思いなのかしら。
予算か、エヴァ。夏井さんも一度終わった話やで。
一度ここで頭を冷やさない？冷たいものでも持ってきてもらいましょうよ。
そうね、頭を冷やした方が賢明そう。あなたもそろそろ一服したくなってきたんじゃない？
姉貴の機嫌が悪そうだからね、一服の方は遠慮するぞ。だが冷たい方は賛成だ。ローザ、誰かに水を持ってこさせてくれ。水差しごとね。
わかったわ。
Rosa headed over to the extension telephone in the corner of the room and called the servant room. She didn't pass on what Rudolph had told her and the person on the other end. Probably Genji. The vicious bickering up till now vanished as though it's been a lie. Silence continued until Goda finished setting up the table and retreated. Finished setting up the table and retreated from the room.
他に何かご入り用のものはございますでしょうか？
ありません。もう下がりなさい。
はい。それでは失礼いたします。
Listening to the sound of Goda's footsteps disappear off to the distance, everyone took a deep breath at the same time to break the tension.
本当にすごい雨ね。19人目の魔女は今頃バラ庭園の東屋で雨宿りでも、うん、
どうか雨はしのげるかもしれないけど少し肩を冷やしそうね。
謎の19人目の来訪、ちょいと推理小説っぽくて面白い話やな。普通この手の話は18人の中の誰かが語ってるだけで、実際には存在せんと相場が決まっとるんや。
私は源氏たちが怪しいと睨んでいます。やはりどんな難癖をつけてでも片翼のわしの使用人たちは全て解雇した方が良かったんです。
まあそういうの、長く勤めてくれた恩もある。もちろん気は許せんね。
兄さんもお父様の仕業かどうかはともかく、あの手紙をマリアちゃんに渡したのは使用人の誰かだろうという点では同意するのね。
Spoiler alert, that's true.
何しろ私たちは夕食までずっと仲良くだ。兄弟全員にアリバイがある。マリアに手紙を渡せたのは使用人の誰かだけだ。
I mean, that's just logic, though. Nobody else could have been it, basically. If there's anybody else on the island in the 18 people, it couldn't have been any of the fucking family members, because they were all accounted for. Except for Rosa, Maria, sorry. Maria and the servants.
ベッドメイクとかで忙しくて、バラ庭園のマリアのところへ行く余裕なんかなかったって。
って言ってたし。
Yeah, somebody was lying.
おいおい、じゃあ何だってんだよ。まさか森の魔女ベアトリーチェ様がお越しになって本当にマリアちゃんに手紙を渡したって言い出すのか。
ローザ、昔は信じててすごい怖がってたものね。あんたまさかいい年してまだ信じてるの？森の魔女。
She did exist. I'd love for her to appear. No matter how much I wish, she didn't appear before me even once. She didn't save me from my crisis.
まさか。でも、18人全員が自分は違うと言っている以上、本当に19人目がいるのかもって思っただけなの。
そんなんあらへんで。第一、謎の乗船者なんぞ。わしらは姿も見とらん。まさかこの荒海を泳いで渡ってきたっちゅんか。ちょいと考えられへんな。
理屈ではそうね。この隔絶された島に招かれていない客が一人隠れているというのは常識的に考えがたいんだけれど、でもどうもその可能性を捨てきれない人たちがいるみたいね。
Hideyoshi had laughed it off, saying there couldn't be a 19th person. But Kirie had sensitively picked up on the delicate atmosphere among the four siblings. In a normal situation, there shouldn't have been any uninvited guests on the small, isolated island.How would they have come here, and from where, and where were they hiding? And why hadn't they appeared openly, even though they had sent a letter in their name? Nothing could explain that. Not even... Oh, but not only had the four siblings not joined in on Hideyoshi's laughing, they also seemed unable to completely deny in their hearts the possibility of a 19th person.
Kirie-san, 誤解しないでいただきたいが、別に私たちはおとぎ話じみた魔女伝説。
またお父様を侮辱する話ですか。それを口にすること自体がお父様への裏切りです。
まあね、でもあのお父様ですもの。あるいは本当にねえ。
私は
なんやなんや、何を見学になっとるんや。どういうことや。つまり魔女伝説は笑い話でも何でもなく事実だっちゅんか。そんなアホな。
もちろん大きにまたがって空を飛ぶ魔女なんてだが、あの肖像画の女エアトリーチは本当にこの島に存在したかもしれない。
秀吉さん、魔女とかの話じゃなくてもっとシンプルな話みたいよ。
A mistress。
つまりこういうことね。ベアトリーチェという名の愛人を
There you go.
お父さんがこの島のどこかに隠れ住まわせていたのではないかとみんなは疑っている。
Kirie lays it out.
そういうことかしら。
Hell yeah.
お父様は事故を厳しく律する模範的な方です。
Except for when he had a mistress.
そのような汚らわしい存在を島に連れ込むなど到底考えられません。
Except for when he had a love child with the mistress. Not so he snapped at them immediately, but it looked like the four siblings, including Kraus, didn't agree.On the contrary, they appeared to think Kinzo wouldn't have even hesitated to do something like that. Yeah, Natsuki, you're a bargain for entree here, girl. Sorry. From the beginning, it had been whispered that Kinzo had built a mansion on this island specifically because of the existence of an entrancing mistress. True. That's very true. We'll confirm that later on.
Yeah, だいぶ昔からそういう噂はあったんだよ。親父は自分一人でこの六軒島の設備全てを作り上げた。屋敷の中には親父しかわからない仕掛けや隠し部屋なんかがあるんじゃないかって。俺たちの知らない秘密の屋敷がこの島のどこかに隠されてるんじゃないかともずっとささやかれてた。
そうね、地図上は小さな島かもしれないけれど、後宮家だけが住むには広大すぎる島だわ。そして未開の森のどこかに愛人を住まわせるための隠し屋敷を作ったかもしれないと、ずいぶんスケールの大きな話ね。
最初はそれはこの屋敷の中じゃないかと言われてた。秘密の地下とかがあったりして、そこに豪華な隠し部屋があり、あの肖像画の魔女が隠れ住んでるんじゃないかと。親父の書斎の凝ったオートロックの仕掛けとかを見てると、それを納得できる。
何しろ莫大な黄金をどこか秘密の場所に秘密の仕掛けで隠したと吹聴する。この屋敷とてまだ我々の知らぬ隠し部屋があったとしても驚くには足りない
。お母様は存命中、よくお父様の不在をついて屋敷内をしらみつぶしに探し回ってたわね。
ルドルフが言ったことをお母様も疑ってたのよ。どこかに秘密の扉や階段があって、その中に金髪の愛人が隠れていると信じていたわ。
It's hard to believe, but there are some actual examples in other countries of people cheating with someone over a period of 7 decades by making them live in a hidden attic room. Furthermore, Kinzo had imagined this extravagance. It was impossible to suspect the existence of a hidden room. Not gonna say anything.
六軒島の魔女伝説って、私の聞いてた話では、子供たちが未開の森に入り込まないようにって言って作った。なんだかそれだけじゃないって気がしてきたわ。
まあ何しろ後宮の屋敷以外に何もない寂しい島だからな。俺やローザがガキの頃はそりゃ雷雨の夜に森その木々の間から不気味な何かが様子を伺ってるんじゃないか。ガキだったら誰でも考える自然なものさ。だが俺やローザがそう訴えるのを聞いて、ガキの妄想だろでは済まさない連中も、そうだろ、姉貴。
私や兄さんは、この島に隠れ住んでいる愛人が、人目を忍んで出歩いていたのを、偶然あんたたちが目撃したのではないかと考えていたわ。もちろん、お母様もね。
古い使用人たちの中にも、深夜の屋敷内に肖像画の魔女が徘徊しているというような怪談。私はそれを表向き怪談として笑い捨てていたが、内心は秘密の愛人の存在を十分に疑っていた。
となるとこの島に19人目の何者かがいるかもしれないってのは全くバカバカしい話でもないっちゅうことなんか。いや、むしろどこかにいるかもしれないわけか。
やっぱり
よくルドルフさんの言う悪魔の証明というやつになったわね。19人目がいることは証明可能だけれど、19人目が存在しないことは証明不能。私たちはベアトリーチェという名の人物が島のどこかに潜んでいることを前提に議論を進めるべきなの。
危機管理の基本としては正しいが、いるわけがないと思うよりはいるかもしれないと用心する方がはるかにマシだろう。
そうやな。すまん、ちょいと不用心が過ぎたわ。ローザさん、さっきは笑ってすまんかったな。
Rosa is so much more timid now. She's not the one that's almost fucking getting the inheritance next in line, right? Last game, she was fucking the next person in line. This game, she's the last person in line. Sucks for her. Silence fell again. Preparing for the existence of the 19th person would mean, in effect, acknowledging the presence of some unknown person hidden on this island. And since this person might be planning something shady, it was only natural that the conversation would turn in an ominous direction.
親父殿はかつて不意に所在を知らせずに姿を消すことがあった。何しろ静寂を好むお人だからな。わざと所在を知らせず、どこかの書庫に閉じこもっているなどということは別に不思議なことで、しかし魔女伝説が愛人説にすり替わり、やがてそれはこっそり愛人のもとへ通っているのではないかと囁かれるようになった。
末期のお袋は疑心暗鬼の塊だったからな。突然大騒ぎして使用人たちに緊急事態だから今すぐ親父を探せなんて騒ぎ始めることがあったっけ。
あったわね。晩年のお母様はそんなことばかりだったから、いまだにその怖い雰囲気が今だから言える。かわいそうな人だったわ。
それでその大々的な矢探しの結果どうだったんや。何か見つかったか。
いいえ。
Never found him because he's a cheating bastard, Kinzo. That's why you don't marry a fucking cheater. Kinzo's wife. Rest in peace.
隠し部屋はおろか、一度たりともお父様が発見されたことはないわ。そしていつも、それからだいぶ時間が経ってからひょっこりと、どこからか姿を現すの。
You just suddenly show up somewhere. Yeah. Where the fuck are you at, dog? No answer?
どこかの書庫で昼寝していたとか、風に誘われて浜辺を散歩していたとか、なんとか言ってね。でもそれらの場所はいずれも使用人たちが必ず探している場所。
Classic lie.
お父様がどこに行っていたのかはいつもわからなかった。当時からお父様はオカルトに傾倒していることが有名だったから、一部の使用人たちは蝶にでも化けてバラ庭園を待っていたのだろうなんて嘘吹いていたっけ。つまりお父さんは誰も知らないどこかへ姿を消すことが頻繁にあった
の。Fucking bastard cheater.
どんなに屋敷中を探しても見つからないんだから、親父は屋敷の外へ行っているのだろうという見解になった。だが屋敷の外ったってそれほど大した場所はない。となると残るのは広大な森だ。それで森の魔女伝説と融合してできた仮説はこうだった。親父は実は森のどこかに隠し屋敷を作っていて、そこにベアトリーチェという名の愛人を住まわせていて、時折通っているんじゃないか。
私も当時は若くてね、親父殿の浮気の現場を抑えてやろうと意気込み、表へ出る親父の後をつけようとしたこともある。もちろん失敗したよ。親父は表へ出るとき異様に人目を嫌い、誰かに見られてないか警戒していた。それこそ異常なくらいね。だから逆に確信したよ。家人に知られてはならぬ理由で出かけているに違いない、ね。
Yeah, it's very suspicious, right?
そら愛人のところへ出かけるんや。
Clearly.
人目も忍ぶやろな。
After seeing Hideyoshi nod and say yes, yes, as though he was quite obvious, Ava got a little sullen.
まあ、とにかく西洋かぶれのお父様が自分の夢をまるでスケッチブックに描くみたいに実現したのがこの島なのよ。すべてがお父様の思い通りの島。愛人を住まわせる隠し屋敷があっても何の不思議もない。
Ava's words spoke for what all the siblings had come to think. For a while the room returned to silence again, and everyone listened to the sound of the wind and the rain.Was there a hidden mansion on the island, and had Kinzel's mistress been living there in hiding for a long, long time? Everyone thought they were being too suspicious. They hesitated for a long time without speaking. Let everyone share the common opinion. Hideo, who had been listening the whole time with her eyes closed, spoke to no one in particular.
そのお父様の愛人の噂はいつ頃から？
この島に引っ越してきた当初からだから、あれこれ30年くらい前だな。何しろ隠し屋敷の工事なんて、俺たちが島に来ちまったら無理だろう。人とか機材の出入りがあるもんな。すぐにバレちまうさ。だから、可能だとしたら、俺たちが引っ越してくる以前。
If you guys ever have an island that you want to build fucking mansions on, definitely make sure you build a secret that fucking mansion and nobody knows about. Just like this guy did. Exactly what he did, by the way. That's true.
多分俺たちがまだ小田原に住んでいた頃に、この屋敷の工事と一緒に済ましていたんだろうね。
お父様は家族生活と愛人との生活の二つを両立させようと最初から想定していたと考えるのが妥当なんでしょうね。多分愛人との関係は小田原時代にまで遡るでしょうし。
だろう。親父殿が言うように、後宮家復興の軍資金となった莫大な黄金が、かの小田原時代にはもう信仰があったと見るべきだろう。莫大な黄金を貸し付けられるだけの信頼関係だ。どれほどの古い縁か想像もつかない。
おそらくお父様が事業で成功する上で、それに恩を感じ、その人物が黄金を与えてくれそうと考えれば、その後も信仰があったのは当然でしょう。それはおそらく愛人というただれた関係ではなく、後宮家の危機を救った恩人としてに違いありません。
ナツさんの言うのも一理あるかもわからんな。だが仮にそうでも、隠し屋敷を作って住まわせるってのはちょいと行き過ぎた話やろな。恩だけでは測れん感情があったんとちゃうか。
A little bit more than gratitude, right? A little bit more.
まあ全ては憶測だ。第一、その隠し屋敷は誰も見つけたことがねえ。
True.
兄貴はこの島をリゾート開発する気なんだろ。その際にひょっこり見つかるかもしれねえぜ。案外そこに黄金もあったりするからな。
お前は六軒島を宝島か何かだとでも思っているのかね。
とぼけないでよ。のトラブルのごたごたでできなくなっちゃったそうだけどね。
なんだか知らんが誤解だな。島の調査はリゾート化の第一段階として極めて当然のことだ。
What a stupid idea, dude. Krauss started to play dumb, but he was plainly obvious to his siblings, who knew him so well. Krauss was definitely sure of the existence of a hidden mansion.And under the pretense of opening a resort, he had been closely investigating the island, searching for a clue as to the location of the hidden gold. He couldn't tell whether that conviction was just him overthinking things, or whether it was based on some physical proof. So, in some scenarios, Krauss is an accomplice? I can't remember if this is one of the scenarios where he's an accomplice.It's kind of clear that Natsumi is not an accomplice at this point. Krauss might be. So it would behoove him to cover up the, any kind of like hidden mansion talk if he can. So he's kind of doing that, so he might be an accomplice. I'm not too sure though. We'll have to play this game over a little bit more. Still, if Kraus with all this guile was sure, that was enough proof for the other siblings to be sure to.
森に魔女が住んでるっちゅうのはそのまんまおとぎ話やが、森の中に誰も知らない屋敷があって金髪の姉ちゃんがひっそり隠れ住んどるっちゅうのも十分おとぎ話やな。
そうね、シチュエーションだけだったらまるで童話か何かみたいね。ローザ、そういうの好きでしょう。
まあね。
この島に屋敷を建てた頃は親父殿の特に全盛期だ。金に物を言わせてどんな妄想も実現したばろう。森の中にひっそり佇む魔女の屋敷、親父の好きそうなシチュエーションだ。
だな、オカルトチックというかメルヘンチックというか。
On this island in which the Usharumiya family had lived for 30 years now, a hidden mansion that no one knew about had been quietly built to house a witch, about whom nothing was known except what could be guessed from the portrait. Even this hastily grown together story, this theory, might not be completely delusional considering all of Kinzo's strange habits and his vast wealth.
お父さんがそういう夢を思い描いて隠し屋敷を建てることは不可能じゃないかもしれない。でも現実的な話、その隠し屋敷に愛する女性を不自由なく何十年にもわたって住まわせることなんて可能なのかしら。
さあ、愛さえあれば可能なんじゃない。
愛する女性が健やかに過ごせるような設備よ。それもお父さんなりのね。それはたとえ規模が小さかったとしても趣向を凝らした快適な邸宅に違いない。そしてそれを維持するには電気、ガス、水道、あるいは身の回りの世話に人間も必要かもしれない。食事の世話だって大変でしょうね。衣服や化粧品、日用品、女の身の回りは簡単じゃないわ。
ハレルヤ。
それだけのものを家人にも使用人にも悟らせずに維持することって可能なのかしら。
そこまで言われると確かに弱いな。だがそれでも親父ならやってのけるかもしれんという気持ちは残る。
Oh, he did it. He did it.
あの親父だからな。
そうね、あのお父様だものね。
お父様はやり遂げることは何があってもやり遂げます。
Oh, Natsu's on board now.
常人には難しいから無理だろうという理由はお父様に関してだけは当てはまらないでしょう。
うん。親父殿に関してだけは親父の狂気は常人の思考では理解にも及ばん。
I wouldn't put it past that, Kinzo. As long as you stick to this phrase, a considerable amount of credibility can dwell in any absurd story.However, that didn't cause the importance of what Kirie said to waver. This was different than stealthily raising a kitten in a cardboard box and keeping it a secret from your parents. Taking care of a person in secret over a period of 30 years had been an incalculably massive task. Yeah, be rich to do it, right? Who's rich in this scenario? Kinzo, right? Okay, it can be done. It can be done easily.
となると、その愛人との縁は30年以上ということになるな。ってことは今いくつなんや。下手をしたらわしらと同じかそれ以上の年齢とちゃうか。体にもボロが出る年頃、どんな屋敷か知らんが人目に触れんようなほとんど軟禁に近い生活はそう快適とは言えんやろな。
そうね、お父様が語るベアトリーチについての話が正しいなら、その縁は当時は魅惑的な若い女性だったかもしれないけど、今は私たちと同格の
タフな食えない女と考えるのが妥当でしょうね。手紙の内容からもそれは容易に想像できるわ。
お前が言うか。
Kraus laughed as his dunce applied to him, the old battle axe. Of course, Eva was offended, but she didn't strike back with her fan in her hand. Not yet.
よせよ、兄貴。そして俺たちの想像が本当なら、親父の遺産問題に彼女は胸を張って参加したいはずなんだ。何しろ、お袋と違い、相思相愛だった可能性が高いから。
Exactly.
本人には愛人の自覚と同時に制裁としての誇りもあるかもしれない。
それはお母様への侮辱に当たりますよ。
ああ、すまん。だが、親父とお袋が親戚の長老たちによる政略結婚だったことは誰もが知ってる。だからこそ、親父に愛人がいてもおかしくないと確信できるわけだがな。
The family sank after the great Kanto earthquake, and father was set up as Ushirimiya family head against his will. However, in the beginning, the elder and relatives treated Kinzo like a dummy and influenced him powerfully, almost like he was a puppet. He wasn't permitted to decide anything by himself, not even his marriage partner. Ever since he met that golden witch Beatrice in those distant days, Kinzo's legend of the girl was quickly embellished into something dramatic.In other words, it can mean that Kinzo really did find a woman he loved. If she also knew the whole story, even if they weren't marriage partners, it wouldn't have been odd for her to consider herself his true wife instead of her heart. And now the person registered as his true wife was already dead.
となると、財産権どころか、家督争いにも食い込む気満々ってことになるでい。
なるほど。この手紙の趣旨が少しだけ見え、碑文の謎を解く者に家督を、そういう意味か。
仮にその愛人が後宮家に序列を得ていたとしても、その序列はお父様の血を直接引かない以上子供に劣る。つまり序列はローザより一つ下ね。とても家督争いに加われるようなレベルじゃないわ。
そういうことか。魔女の碑文を解けば序列に関係なく家督が継げる。つまり全く可能性のないベアトリーチェにとって最も有利な条件ってわけだ。
The revival of the Ushirimiya family was made possible by the gold Beatrice had bestowedwas quite a distinguishing servant she had provided. She had built the wealth together with Kinzo, so it was natural that she would think of herself as the one who should inherit it. It would also be natural for her to despise the thought of giving it up to the children of the wife Kinzo never loved.
Zuzushi にも程があります。仮に愛人が実在したとしても、当主継承権を争うなど身の程をわきまえぬ暴挙です。なんという身の程知らず。
Natsu turned red, fist quivering. She had also come into the Ushirimiya register due to complicated circumstances. Those who knew that understood more or less why she was so angry for the sake of Kinzo's dead wife.
まあ、その暴挙のおかげで私たちにも公平にチャンスがあるわけなんだけどね。それにお父様はこの暴挙を黙認されている。後宮家を継ぐのは愛人ベアトリーチェか。あ、それを争わせて確かめたいというのでしょうね。
As Eva giggled roguishly, Kraus shrugged his shoulders and looked away.
でもその条件を向こうが出してきたということは、向こうは十分な賞賛があるということじゃないのかしら。
Oh yeah.
それもそうや。
You're not wrong.
第一、ベアトリーチェはあの手紙の文面通りなら、つまり黄金の管理者や。その隠し場所を知っていても何の不思議もないやないか。こらひどい話やで。答えを知っているなぞなぞを出してきたも同じや。 これでシャーシャーと現れて、これが答えや、家督はいただきやで、なんて言われたら、わしらすべてかっぱらわれちまうわ。
She won't do that, but she might as well do that, because you guys are going to figure it out.
そうね。なぞなぞの出題者は、常、これは、私たちからすべてを奪うために作られた罠の可能性が高いわ。
そこまで考えると、そもそも彼女が本当に黄金を持っているかどうかは怪しい。なぜ我々にその存在を黙って着服すればよいもの。
確かにおかしな話だな。
That certainly was the caseIf the epitaph showed the way to the hidden gold, why would she challenge them and try to solve it? If they actually did solve it, wouldn't the gold all be stolen from her? Could it be that this person was trying to stir the siblings up so they'd solve the epitaph, and then plan to steal it away at the last second? It was an extremely logical possibility.
いいえ。チェス盤をひっくり返して考えれば、黄金を実際に持っている可能性は低くないかもしれない。
You have to spin that chessboard around, though.
どうしてそんなことが断言できるのよ。
待て、姉貴。キリエ、続きを話してくれ。どうしてそう思うんだ。
だって、私たちは魔女の碑文なんていう、本気で後宮家の家督を明け渡す気？なぞなぞの答えに感服して降参を？
そらも、それも。そうや、なぞなぞの答えを教えられたくらいで、わしらがあっさり降参して家督を「はいどうぞ」と渡すかっちゅうたら、そら甘い話やな。
当然です。後宮家の家督をそんな程度のことで譲ることがあるわけがない。そういうことよ。いくらベアトリーチェが一方的にこんなゲームを提案しても、そして私たちは家督を素直に譲るわけもない。つまり私たちがこのゲームに対等な条件で挑まなくてはならないという強制力がない限り、このゲームは成立しないのよ。
そうだな。負けた時、家督を譲ることに強制力を持たせなきゃこのゲームは成立しない。
その強制力というのはどういう、我々を鎖で縛って家督を譲るよう脅迫でもしようというのかね。
なるほど、わかったわ。私たちが喜んで家督を放棄したくなるようにすればいいわけね。なるほど、ならば確かにベアトリーチは10トンの黄金を持っていなければならない。
そうか、わしにもわかったで。つまり取引っちゅうわけやな。
どういう意味ですか。取引？何を。
後宮家の家督と隠し黄金をよ。ベアトリーチェはきっと10トンの黄金の所在を明かし、それで後宮家の家督を買収するつもりなのよ。
バカバカしい。栄光ある後宮家の家督をお金でやり取りしようというのですか。冒涜です。後宮家への冒涜です。
怒らずに聞いて。その栄光ある後宮家には今どの程度、私たちはそんなにも裕福なの。
裕福の定義とは財産で決まる、心の持ちようで決まります。
Kraus interrupted Natsuhi as she started to go on and on emotionally. In this situation, the more she went on like that, the worse it would actually sound.
私はともかく、お前たちの状況は芳しくないと聞いている。
あーら、そう。兄さんの財政状況だって相当にか。次々担保に入れて新しい博打の掛け金にして。負けを認めないために次々内情の話をしたら、この中で兄さんほど火の車の人間はどれだけ損失を出してんの。才能ないのよ。
誰の才能がないというのですか。皮膚にこと書き、火の車とは。
Natsui became indignant once more, but Kraus raised his hand again and interrupted her.
多少の誤解があるよ。ビジネスは経過で判断できるものではない。私のような長期的視野でのビジネスとも、時に短い単位期間では一見大きな損失を出しているようにも見える。
兄貴、裏は取れています。裏は見栄を張ってる場合じゃない。つまりキリエはこう言いたいのさ。俺たちは全員が全員、そしてベアトリーチェ、10トンの黄金を。
ベアトリーチェは自分だけがアリカを知る10トンの黄金で、私たちに家督を売らせるつもりなの。10トンの黄金の価値はどのくらい？
ざっと見積もって
20億。いえ、200億ね。これだけを積まれたら、私たちは歓喜して彼女を次期当主に認めるわ。
The scene returned to silence. In fact, the rain and wind felt even noisier now. It was probably the sound of the windstorm racing through the insides of their minds.
そら損得勘定は必要やろが、聞くに値する話や。
They knew that Kraus had eaten up much of the Usurumiya family's assets. So it was dregs that remained of that inheritance versus the cost of being accepted as the head that Beatrice would pay. But the shame, but honestly, the former was less enticing than the latter.
まあ、四等分とはならねえだろうな。次期当主を降りることになる兄貴に取り分が多くなるのは羨ましい話だぜ。
あなた、金額の問題じゃないでしょ。不甲斐ない弟たちはお金で後宮家の栄光を売り払うつもりなのですよ。ここで長男の威厳を示さずして何とするのです。
She's way too good for him. You can already see that, guys, right?
夏希、しばらく黙っていなさい。
ね、stay quiet for a while, girl. Such a last up.
あなた！
She's talking too much sense.
こりゃクラッとくる話。俺たちは兄貴から2億半ずつ引っ張ろうと思ってた。もし魔女様が俺たちに10トンの
About 4 billion.
20億ね。
Oh, 2 billion, my bad. 2 billion.
ああ、俺たちは当初の見積もりの10倍も弾まれちまうことになる。そんだけあれば俺たちは十分だぜ。どうせ後宮なんて名前に未練はねえんだ。喜んで売っ払ってやら。
10トン全てを提供してくれるかは、さす、なるほど。私たちにとって魅力的、私たちは、ベアトリーチェなどというよそ者を弾き出すために、兄弟同盟、しかし、彼女の目、私たち兄弟の団結はバラ、ええ。今こそはっきり断言、ベアトリーチェの手紙の目的は、私たちの結束をかき乱すことなのよ。
The three younger siblings who never had anything to do with the inheritance were paid enough money to satisfy them, they would happily accept Beatrice at the next head. A moat has been dug all around Kraus. In that case, the negotiations would be one-on-one between her and Kraus.He tried to look strong, but Kraus's financial and political situation was extremely weak. He might bluff in front of the siblings, but on the inside, he was considering entering negotiations, depending on the sum of money involved. In order to bury his losses, Kraus had taken advantage of the fact that Kinzo had shut himself up in his room and had embezzled Kinzo's personal assets. Therefore, when Kinzo died and the inheritance was distributed, Kraus's situation would probably be investigated.What if he gave up his seat as the head to Beatrice? She would also receive rights to the asset, and as a result, the distribution of the inheritance to the siblings would not occur. In other words, Kraus's embezzlement might not have to be made known to the other siblings. Of course, the siblings were frightened of Kinzo, but it was doubtful whether they were still actually respected to him as father. By this time, they each had their own families, their own wealth, and their own lives. they were paid enough money in exchange for Rokinjima, the wreckage of Kinzo's dreams, there was a significant likelihood that they relinquished the Isurima family name. In other words, Beatrice's victory was already guaranteed in this game. Not as the winner of Beatrice's game, but as the winner of Kinzo's game. Kinzo once ordered that the epitaph would be put on display, and until today, no one had solved it. So Beatrice solved it. In other words, this is less of a game and more like Beatrice's declaration of victory. However, Kiryu still thought there might be a catch. This was the declaration of victory. Beatrice would only have had to display the code openly and state her intent to buy the inheritance. And yet she had gone to all this trouble, telling the siblings to try and solve the epitaph. Why did she set up this new game? Was she agreed to hand over all the gold and the inheritance to the epitaph solver? Why? Kiryu tried sending the chessboard around several times. She searched for the sort of ideal strategy Beatrice might be after, something that could lead to this kind of thinking. But in the end, she reached a single conclusion. There was no conclusion.
Ogori. なのか、あるいは遊び？何の話？魔女は碑文を解いてみろと私たちに挑戦状を送ったわ。どうせ解けないだろうと鷹をくくってるでしょうけどね。でも何万分の1かの確率で私たちが解いてしまう可能性もあるはず。何しろここにはお父さんの血を引く子供が4人もいるのよ。出題者の血縁者が4人も揃い、財産を奪われまいと死に物狂いで知恵を出し合ったなら、偶然にも謎が解けてしまうこともあるかもしれない。
True. The reason the witch had a superior position in negotiations compared to the siblings was that only she knew the location of the hidden guild. But if that hiding place was exposed to someone other than her, the witch's advantage would crumble.
つまり魔女の手紙に書かれている挑発文はベアトリーチェにとってリスクにしかならないのよ。確かに兄弟の連帯を分断するという効果はあったけれど、それを狙うためだけにわずかとはいえこのようなリスクを、私は不用心だと思う。でもね、ある種の感情を念頭に置いた時、このリスクは理解可能になるのよ。
I think we've mentioned this in episode 2, but for magic to actually work, you have to have some kind of risk, basically. So that's pretty much why whoever's calling herself Beatrice did this, because she needs to risk that the siblings will actually figure out this epitaph to make the fucking Twilight shit work. So this tip won't work unless they fucking get some risk in there. That's pretty much why she's doing this, to keep things fair.But as you can see, in episode 1 and episode 2, like, nobody solves the epitaph because they're all dumbasses. So we'll see if it happens in episode 3 differently, but not looking too good, though. But there is going to be a little bit of element of risk for Beatrice in doing all of her magical shit, because she needs to have risk to do magic.
それがおごりだというの？ええ。そうよ。圧倒的な優位に立つと人はすると敗者に対し、その優位性をひけらかすために微小なリスクをわざと背負うことがある。適度なリスクは勝利の喜びを引き立たせるスパイスだもの。リスクなき勝利ほど退屈なものはない。
わかるわ。私もそういうのよくわかるわ。
ベアトリーチェの手紙の真意をもっともらしくいろいろと解釈してみたけれど、実はこれが真実かもしれない。あの手紙の裏に潜む感情はおごりなのよ。
おごり。
難解な碑文がお前たちに解けるものかと私たちを見下して威張り散らしたいのよ。
案外ひょっとすると碑文はお父さんじゃなく彼女が作ったのかもしれないわね。上等じゃないの。
碑文の謎が解けるかですって。
も
しも解いたなら私を当主にしてくれるのね。
Right.
解いてやる。魔女の挑戦を受けてやるわ。他の間抜けな兄弟たちに解けるものか。私一人が解いて、私こそが後宮家を引き継ぐにふさわしいということを証明してやるわ。
その挑戦、私が謎を解いてやる。
Yes, ma'am. Best character.We at 10 o'clock, or sorry, 9 o'clock now. First day still. The killings don't happen till midnight, so we got another 3 hours at least before shit happens. So don't get an alarm, guys. 3 hours in game time.
なるほどな。魔女じゃなく。ベアトリーチェという名の愛人が島に存在していたわけか。
That's right.
つまり、人間は18人以上いる。
Well, we'll figure out if there is or isn't.
ということは、
18人全員に不可能だから、
魔法犯罪であるという図式は崩せるわけだ。これは大きい情報だぜ。
失礼いたします。マトラ様、紅茶とクッキーはいかがですか？
Want some cookie? Beato's butler called himself Ronov Ronove. Put it out of nowhere. A plate set on a silver tray that he had held with, was filled with delicious looking steaming black tea and cookies. I really don't like this guy's smile. A little sus. For some reason doesn't look like a smile I used toWarmly greet of guest. Looks like he's mocking me somehow. I don't know if he really takes me for an idiot, or if it's just a joke or something, but it's really irritating me. I'm gonna knock that fucking mustache off his face in a second.
いらねえよ。俺は今取り込み中なんだ。ほっといてくれ。
Leave me alone!
それはそれは美味しく焼けたクッキーなのに、人間ごときにはもったいないくらいに素敵に焼き上がった。それはそれは素敵なクッキーなの。
気が向いたら食ってやるぜ。その辺に置いてとっととうせな。
さようでございますか。それではそのようにいたしますよ。冷めてからお召し上がりになって、焼きたてを召し上がらなかったことを存分に後悔なされると良いでしょう。
You think it's a poison dog, you know that. You don't want to eat that shit.
いちいちうるさいやつだな。まあ、耳元で気色悪くケラケラ笑うベアトのやつよりゃすぐマシだがよ。
いえいえ、まっとく。お嬢様の笑い声は時折実に品があります。それを聞くたびに、なぜ私ほどの高貴な悪魔があのようなものを主にしなければならないのか。
Talking some shit.
変なやつだな。そんなに嫌なら使えなきゃいいだろうな。
There's a contract, dog. Can't fuck with the contract with the demon.
それでも名を使いするのは家具の喜びなので、それでなくては家具は務まりません。それはさておき。先ほど良い情報を見つけたようなことを言われ、さてさて。どのような浅知恵が思いついた
の。 Shallow wit. As Ronove mocked me and giggled, he followed my earlier words literally and placed the back tea and cookies in a random spot nearby.
おかった。19人目の存在に自信を深めたからでございましょう。よろしければ、ぜひご講説をお聞かせ願いますか。
Don't do it. Don't tell him.
ああ。どうせベアトの前で改めて言うしな。隠す必要もないさ。いいか。
There's every reason to hide it, idiot. She's gonna know what you're gonna think.
この島に隠し屋敷があって、愛人を住まわせていたらしいんだ。となりゃ、 俺を苦しめてきた18人なのか19人なのかって疑問。
マトラ様は魔女を否定するくせに18人の中にも犯人を求められないダブルスタンダードの袋小路に自らも追い込まれました。
魔女を否定する最も簡単な方法は、18人全員のアリバイはそうか、常に1人くらいはアリバイのも、俺はそいつを生贄にすることで常に魔女を否定し続けることもでき、しかしそ、あーダメだぜ、全然ダメだ、
全然ダメだぜ。
18人はみんな俺にとって親たちやし、そして真面目だったり面白かったりする、俺はその人たちの誰を生贄にすることも許せない。かつて俺はその決意があやふやだった。だからその心の弱さベアトに疲れたんだ。
自らの弱点を認め、なかなかできることではありません。槍というよりは盾でしょうか。いずれにせよ、これまでのゲームでの無策と違う戦い方に指針を持たれるのは劇的飛躍と申せましょう。
You're still acting like a dumbass though, so you want to admit that there's somebody else that could be a killer, even if they might be a relative slash servant. And then you also want to admit they're just no bitch. That's, it doesn't make any sense. You can't have it both ways.
これでバトラ様は敬愛する18人を存分に19人目を疑い、人間犯人説を追求でき、
そういうこと。最初のゲームのカノン君が殺され、他にも19人目が存在していたなら迷う必要なんかないトリックはいくつもある。つまり18人の誰にも無理だからという図式だけは否定することができるわけさ。
ふむふむ、とても良い一手だ。私だったらどう切り返しましょうか。たとえバトラ様が理解された18人攻めは有効な手でしょうね。バトラ様の守りがどの程度か確かめる意味でも、改めてそこを突く。
ならどう来る、悪魔の執事。
バトラ様が刺された19人目の駒を迎え撃つのが妥当でこ、バトラ様は19人目にお会いしておりませんね。
Devil's proof.
19人目が存在する証拠をお願いできますか。
アメーゼ、もちろんその差し手で来るだろうことは読んでいる。
それはそれ、受け手をお願いいたします。
魔女だの悪魔だの、お前らにこれほどふさわしい言ってはそれがこいつ
Devil's proof。
悪魔の証明さ。
You try to make some claims to humans like us, we always counteract by telling you to show some proof. Because that's a human move. Now, I'm fighting with a witch. I'm taking part in a battle with someone who isn't human. Some moves exist that can only be used in a game against a witch. They are cheap moves. And that's what the civil proof is. Because it's impossible to prove. Let's assume that there's a hidden mansion on Rokinjima separate from the Ushirimiya family mansion. That a woman named Beatrice lives there.In order to prove this, one must find the mansion and actually bring Beatrice out of it. It's called an actual proof in the human world. However, if we follow the rules of the devil's proof, you can't deny that she exists, even if there's no proof that she does. Because it's impossible to prove that something doesn't exist. Another way to see this, devil's proof of there being life on Mars, because we've never been to Mars to actually check if there is life there. Could be. There's no way to prove it, right? No way to prove there's not.So you can't say that there's no life on Mars. Same difference. That's right, I'm finally able to turn the tables using the devil's proof. It tormented me so much before. Those guys were always trying to force me to accept the existence of the witch with it, and after all, it was physically impossible for me to show any proof that witches don't exist and deny Beato's claims. That's why I kept getting hit with the reckless argument that witches do exist and was unable to counterattack. And that's why I'll spill the chessboard around one more time. If I can't disprove the existence of witches, then that means suggest that a 19th human exists, you can't deny that either. In other words, because this problematic and mysterious mistress is craftily hiding herself, it'd be perfectly natural if you've never found her, no matter how hard you looked. So you can't say that your inability to find this 19th person proves that she doesn't exist. Therefore, it's impossible to deny the 19th person's existence. You have to use the devil's proof to make it, denying your own existence impossible. But this time, it's become my weapon. If he can get away with this argument, then forget just the 19th person. This side can be full of people we don't know about. Even if there were 10 or 100 of them, she still couldn't deny they existed. In the last game, the one before that, among the murder scenes that showed up, there were several that were extremely intricate and must have taken a lot of effort to set up. It's really hard to imagine a single culprit setting up all this. However, if not just the 19th person, but 10 or 100 people were hidden somewhere, that wouldn't be a problem at all. They all split up the work. They could handle any job in a short period of time. Of course, doubts would naturally arise as to whether a large group of people like that could sneak around the mansion without being noticed. But those are all settled by the devil's proof. You can't deny that even 100 people were there just because they weren't seen or noticed. There you go. Even though I'm saying it myself, it's such a stupid argument that it makes me want to throw up. However, because it's such a dirty move, it's a perfect one to use against the witch. Well, this is just my imagination. What if about 100 suspicious men wearing goat masks were hiding in the shadows? Something like that's worse than laughable, almost like they're cockroaches. If you see one, it means there's 100 more hiding somewhere.
まあ、屁理屈まみれの暴論だとは思うぜ。相手が人間だったなら、寝言を言うなと怒鳴られるところだろうよ。だが、俺の相手は魔女だ。そして俺たちがやってるのはそういう勝負なんだろう。どんな暴論であろうとも人間で説明をつけ魔女を否定する。とにかくこの一手で俺は二度と親しい18人のみんなを疑わなくて済む。俺は二度と前回の失敗は繰り返さない。
なるほど、良いことですよ。さすがに3度もゲームを重ねると容量が良くなるものです。まずは自陣の守りを固める。実に堅実な処方です。なかなかの妙手と思いますよ。
まあ19人目の人物を仮定したとしても、マスターキーの本数などのように何人人間を増やしてもクリアできないトリックも残ってる。しかし、とりあえずの初手としては悪くないはずだ。
バトラ様の切り札、19人目の人物という大駒、証拠はあるのかとの私の一手に、バトラ様は悪魔の証明で反撃。良い攻防で、お嬢様のおられないところで、私も少し面白くなって、お嬢様に代わりさらに行って進め。
魔女だろうと悪魔だろうと相手に不足はねえ。
バトラ様の刺された一手、これは私ども悪魔のお箱でございますが、ヘンペルのカラスという一手はご存知ですかね。
ヘンペルの何の話だ。
Just in awe, that enraging laugh I've heard so many times started echoing. There she is. The room was filled with dazzling golden butterflies. In the center of that whirlwind, the golden witch appeared.
これはこれは、お嬢様、おはようございます。
わらわのいないところで何やら面白そうなことをしていると思うが、ヘンペルのカラスか。 なんとも笑える懐かしい一手よ。よもやバトラに披露する日が来ようとはな。それは悪魔の証明に並ぶ古典的一手だ。ロノウェイ、それはわらわが指す一手ぞ。わらわの楽しみを減らしてくれるな。
出やがったな、ゲラゲラ魔女め。相変わらず下品に笑いやがって。こいつもお前のこと、笑い方に品がねえって陰口言ってたぜ。まあ、
それは心外な。本当か？
そうもない。心より尊敬申し上げているお嬢さん、この私めがどうしてそのような陰口を申せましょうか。
よくもシャーシャーと言えるもんだな。お前とは仲良くなれそうにないぜ。
まあよい、話を戻そう。テンペルのカラスは実証を待遇的に行ってみせる。つまりこういう手だ。カラスが黒いことを証明するにはどうすればいい？
あ？何の話だ？カラスが黒いことを証明って。
その通り、カラスイコール黒いを証明すればよい。ということは、黒くない鳥イコールカラスではないを証明しても同じ論法になるのがわかるかな？世界中のカラスでない鳥をすべて調べ、それらが黒くないことを証明すれば、それは結果的に、故に黒い鳥はカラスであるとな。これを待遇論法という。そなたには難しいか？
ああ、ま、何言ってやがるのかさっぱりだ。
バトラ様、二つの箱があり、片方は当たりで、もちろんもう片方は外れで空っぽです。
For example, here are two boxes where one has a cookie inside and means you win, while the other is empty and means you lose. At this moment, it has a cookie inside equals you win, which implies that you did not win equals they had no cookie inside. When such a relationship exists, the latter is called the contrapositive. If A, then B is true, then if not B, then not A is also true. Make sense?
そりゃ当然だろう。もし選んだ方が外れだったなら、もう片方は自動的に当たり、つまり箱を適当に選び、最初の一手でどっちの箱にクッキーが入っているか特定できるわけだ。
その通り。開けた箱にクッキーが入っていたなら、悪魔の証明を満たす。この箱は当たりイコールこの箱にはクッキーが入っ、しかし開けた箱が空っぽだったなら、この時は逆にテンペルのカラスを満たす。
You can still prove that the other box has the fucking cookie in it, even though you didn't get the proof that you needed. Makes sense. It's an advanced concept and logic, but makes sense.
この箱にクッキーが入っていないイコールこの箱は当たりではない。そしてそれは箱が2つしかないことを前提と、もう片方の箱が自動的に当たりであることを待遇的に示している。
ああ、ま、なんとなく理屈は分かったぜ。毒を制するには毒、へりくつにはへりくつってわけだ。それで俺の島には19人目の人間が隠れているに違いないから、18人全員にアリバイがあってもそれは魔女を認めることにはならないを、どう切り返してくれるった？
よかろう。わらわの手は教えよう。まず、そなた。
Teach you, battler.
18人の中に犯人はいない。Fucking debates. イコール。ならば犯人は19人目としている。ならば待遇としてこうなるわけだ。つまり、犯人は19人目ではない。イコール。ならば18人の中に犯人がいる。
Mm-hmm.
あんたと、それはどういう意味だ。
そなたの指し手を逆…
そう難しい話ではあるまい。
ロノエ、説明せよ。そなたのさっきのクッキーの箱の例えは、バトラに分かりやすいらしい。
それでは僭越ながら、先ほどの例え話で、もう一度ご説明させていただきます。
Allow me to read my earliest story about two treasure boxes, one of which has a cookie in it.In this situation, you have an 18-person box and a 19-person box. So, the cookie represents the culprit. Adler-sama. Let's say you open the 18-person box. Because the cookie is not there, you have paradoxically proven that, therefore, the cookie is in the 19-person box. That lets us make an even more paradoxical claim. In other words, if it was first shown that the 19-person box was empty,It would prove, at the same time, that the cookie is in the 18-person box. That makes sense. Badler Sama played this move in order to avoid having to doubt any of the 18. But it's now been used to prepare an 18-person attack. That's what happens. When you give your fucking strategy away to a demon.
Warawanga.19人目の箱の中身が空っぽであることを先に証明する。そなたは自動的に18人の箱の中にクッキー。そなたはそれを逆の言い方で口にしたに過ぎんのだぞ。
つまり俺の自信満々の一手は同時にモロ刃の剣でもあるってわけか。
その通りよ。どなたの19人目で全てを説明する一手は18人でしか説明できないことを認めざるを得ないリスクを背負っている。
I see. Hempel's Raven. So this is a countering technique. What if I really think about it? This counter is really disadvantageous for me. This isn't the cookie we're talking about.It's if I imagine that the loser treasure chest has actually a bomb in it, it gets even clearer. There aren't just two treasure chests, but 18 plus one more for the 19th person. If you think of it as having a total of 19 boxes, it gets even easier to picture. First of all, one of the premises of the human culprit theory is that the bomb will definitely be in one of those boxes. I didn't want to place a bomb in the boxes of any of the 18, so I used the devil's proof. It created a 19th person box, so I can throw the bomb in there.That much is fine. But then Beato struck back. Now if the contents of the 19th person box are empty, that'll automatically mean that the bomb's in one of the other 18 boxes. If I could examine what's inside all 18 of those boxes, and as long as I can show that the bomb isn't in any of them, I'll be able to safely show that the 18 are innocent. If that were possible, I'd have nothing to fear. However, in reality, that'd be almost absolutely impossible. Oops. Police wouldn't come here in this typhoon.We don't have access to scientific investigations or experts or anything. In short, we can't prove anything decisively. It would be impossible for me to find any proof other than simply gulping down whatever alibis each of the 18 give. That means I personally have to prove their innocence, and I have to do it perfectly. Like by staying with them the whole time, never letting them out of my sight for a second. By doing that, I could probably be sure that that person's innocence. Sure that the bomb isn't in their box.However, in practical terms, that'd be impossible. In other words, I had to explain an incredible effort just to check the contents of one box. There are 18 of them. In other words, unless I bound all 18 of them up in chains and watch over them, it'd be impossible to prove that all of them have empty boxes. However, Beato is only to open one box, the 19th person box, and show that it's empty to prove that the bomb's in one of the other 18 boxes. Furthermore, there's no need for her to show which of the 18 boxes has the bomb. You got 18 times more work to do and explain my pet theory than Beatrice does for hers. Because you're a dumbass. Don't want to accuse anybody else.
世の中には悪魔の反論に膨大な手間がかかり、事実上不可能であるケースが少なくない。しかし、ヘンペルのカラスはその問題を逆手に取り、容易に実証することを可能。
テンペルのカラスを使えば様々な暴論が実証可能なのです。例えば私以外の人間イコール愚かであるという命題があったとします。これを証明するには本来私を除く全人類を調べ、
愚かであることを証明しかし何十億人も調べるなどマトラ様の18箱を開ける手間と全く同じです
しかしヘンペルのカラスならばその命だつまり私以外の人間イコール愚かであるをそなチェス盤をひっくり返し愚かではないイコール私として証明しても良いということだつまりどういうことだと思うわらわが聡明であるという全人類は愚かであることの何十億人分もの証明が直ちに終了してしまうわけだ全人類がわらわよりも愚かであることをわずか1秒もかけずに証明終了できる世界最強最速の QED
ナイス
コペンペルのカラス
なんつ暴論だよ
I mean they're both ridiculous arguments to be honest to say that oh you don't have any proof so this is it you can't rule it out 100%Or to say, oh, the opposite is true, so that shit has been ruled out, even though I'm saying that everybody else is foolish compared to me. Oh, the opposite is true, I'm wise, then everybody else is foolish, right? I mean, you can't say that it's not at that point. That's the same kind of stupidity that you have in the Devil's Proof argument, which you didn't realize when you made that argument first. So, it's not a get out of free jail card, dumbass. You gotta have a real argument, pretty much.
これはとてもとても便利な一手ですよ悪魔どころか神々も好む一手です幸福であるイコール神のしもべを命題とするとき待遇は神のしもべでない人間イコール幸福であってはいけないとなります、
うん、
つまり神のしもべがその加護によって幸福であることをその加護を受けぬ人々が不幸であることを実証すればいいわけですそして彼らは自らの神を信じない人々を不幸に突き落とすことで自らの幸福を実証
人に幸福を与えるにはバッしかし人を不幸にするのに必要なコストははるかに安上がりだ
That's true.
つまりヘンペルのカラスを使えば神々は実に低コストで信者に加護の喜びを与えられるわけよ
Very good line.
あ、悪魔だ悪魔の理論だ
Definitely is
めちゃくちゃだ
話が逸れてしまったようだなそろそろ話を戻そうぞわらわの反撃の一手はいっそなたの19人目が犯人だからならば19人目が犯人でないことを証明できたら18人か魔女のどちらかが犯人ということで確定するぞとの確認だ
For a while I just stood there shocked completely forgetting and closed my mouthThis one I thought I countered one of their strong points. Their counterattack had been this reckless argument that I couldn't possibly have anticipated. Is this going to be impossible after all? To continue designing the witch on the island with no more than 18 people, it's going to be impossible as long as you don't try to, like, suspect the other 18 people, dipshit. Because who else is there to suspect if it's not fucking a witch? Right? And still believe in the innocence of 18 people. It's not going to happen.Is that just a delusion? Yes. Am I just trying to escape reality? Yes. Yes! 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 Sad to see that Bryan Danielson is leaving WWE. He might be back, but I think he's going to New Japan Pro Wrestling. He's going to probably do some independent stuff for a while. But won't be seeing him on TV for a while, basically.That's how, you know, try to tune in some Japanese stations or something like that. He had a good run. I'm glad I gave him a WrestleMania title match, at least, for his last big match against Roman Reigns on SmackDown. That was pretty awesome. And then he got banned from SmackDown after he lost. After Jey Uso screwed him over, so... He went out on good terms, at least, from that company. Kind of like made him a superstar. So I'm happy to see that. Much better than a lot of people like Gail Scott. Like, Samoa Joe didn't get anything like that. Or the Iconics. Or Mojo Rawley didn't get anything like that. He hasn't been on TV in like years. And he's got fucking released a couple weeks ago. Oops. Thanks for coming, Mojo. Not yet. Who's this talking? Don't give up this desperate struggle yet. Who cares about whoever's Raven? They're just trying to confuse me by bringing up this weird bits of trivia. I use the Devil's Proof. Don't feel uncertain about something you've used once. Leave in the spear you've drawn, and then forcibly gouge it in. Yeah, it can still work if you use it, yeah.
まだまだ序盤だぞ。この程度で調光するつもりか？
な、いや待て。確認するぞ。確かに俺は、わかりやすく19、悪魔の証明によって18人以上人間、それは、10人いるか100人いるかもわからない。不特定多数ということだ。お前が想定する人数より常に一人、わかるか？
ふん。They counted my twisted logic with something even more twisted. So the only thing I could counter to that would be even crazier twisted logic. That's not a bad move, actually. So you proved that the 19th person didn't do it? How about the 20th person? How about the 21st? How about the 22nd? 23rd? 24th? Blah blah blah.
わらわが19人目のアリバイを何だ？その瞬間にそなたは20人目を生み出し犯人だと主張する。
Yes, sir.
これを無限に繰り返すことによって。わらわは永遠に彼らのアリバイの証明が終えられないというわけか。なるほどなるほど。さながらイナゴの大群を呼び出す魔王よな。さすがは金蔵の孫よ。召喚術の才能には恵まれていると見える。
つまり18人以外の存在 X は常にアリバイを証明することが不可能なんだ。
Right.
どうだベアト、ヘリクス合戦だと分かれば俺も負けねえぜ。
愚かしいぞ。わらわを誰と心得る。わらわこそは無限の魔女。そのわらわに無限にて挑むとは片腹痛いわ。無限を操ることはつまり無限を殺すこともできるということ。わらわが19人目を切れば、そなたは20人目を切れば21人目を呼び、21人目を切れば22人目を切れば
23
人目を呼び、34人目を呼び、 6,435,2,237,567,33,034,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,
I mean, it's not a bad move though, right?
If
you say something red, it's not a bad move. What are you gonna do?
わらわに無限は通じぬわ。
ほう。ならばどうやってこの俺の無限を殺すんだよ。見せてみろよ。
Probably.
わらわには真実を赤で語る力があろうが。
Yep. You forgot about that one.
来やがったな。
By the way, episode 3 is the, by far the most read statements in any of the episodes so far. So, start writing these down if you, if you're trying to solve this mystery, guys. Start writing these things down.
わらわが赤で語るとき、そこには一切の幻想がない。わらわがこの島には100人しかいないと一言赤で、そなたにはもはや101人目を生み出すことはかなわぬのだ。
Oh, okay.
ほーら、バトラ。
We're still gonna cap it off at maybe 25?
今度はどんな真実を赤で語ってみせようか。どんな拠り所を叩き切って、そなたを絶望に突き落としてやろうか。ゾーラ、 いつもの怯えた顔を見せてみるがいい。
Yeah, she likes to toy with him, doesn't she? Don't give it up, battler. Come on, battler.
Nani?
Don't cry. Oh.
Sonata. Warau ka?
What a kind of creepy look I had on my face as I laughed right then. That red sure is scary. Every time it jumps out, I'm driven into the depths of hopelessness. But I've already realized something. There is no need to be overly afraid of the red.
また抜きやがったな。殿下の宝刀だ。それで
今度はベアトリーチェ様は何をどう赤で語ってくださるってんだ。
それはどういう意味か。急に余裕を見せおって。
悪いが、その真っ赤な宝刀は俺も抜いてくれるのを待ってたんだ。さて、お前は今度は何を赤で宣言してくれるんだ。言っとくが、そいつは自爆だぜ。その時点でお前は魔女説を自ら捨てたも同然。
That's right.
まさに投了だ。確かに俺にとっても。
That's rightThe red wasn't always a weapon that worked in Beato's favor alone. It was the other way around. If she used it in the wrong way, it'd be dangerous enough that she could bring about her own death. If she used it carelessly and said something that ended up denying herself, that'd be exactly the same as self-destructing. So whoever I know, that's why she'll never say, oh, there's only 18 people on this island in red. Because if she says that, then obviously there's no witch on the island at that point.She can't give a concrete number about, oh, there's 19 people on the island, or there's 20 people on the island. Because she disproves that the 19th person didn't kill. And that doesn't leave any other people to be a witch, basically. So she can't just name a fucking random number out without accounting for the witch in the red text. So she has to think about what she's doing here.
たとえ誰が犯人であっても、俺はきっと辛い気持ちに。だが、人間が犯人だとお前が赤で語ることは、お前の投了宣言にも等しい。お前が俺と差し違えても相打ちにしたいってんなら、それも面白い一手だろうぜ。だが、この勝負は俺の勝ちで終わる。
There you go. I'm going to reset my shit real quick. Beatrice's red was a true trump card. Oops, hold on. There you go. When that person speaks in red, it's definitely the truth, and no amount of proof or chrono arguments can change that. Until now, she's used it to severely wound me, and each time, the tiny foundation supporting my heart gets split in half.However, she uses it carelessly, I can also glean little information about the truth. In the last game, I used that to my advantage, especially during the chapel's closed room trick. I almost completely got her boxed in at one point. But she was pretty sly herself. She learned from experience and then started using the discretion in the timing of her red. Feeling of tension was almost literally like a battle with real red swords. This is a high-level intellectual battle!No, not an intellectual battle. This really is twisted logic. This was the world's craziest and worst battle of twisted logic.
さあ、今度はお前の手番だぜ。そうさ、お前のヘンペルのカラスを、まず18人以外に何人の人間がいるのかを赤で確定させる必要がある。
Yes, sir.
その上で、それらの人間について、さらに赤で犯人でないことを宣言したならば。なるほど、こいつは俺にとって致命傷になるだろうぜ。
あれほど怯えていた赤を、もはや微塵も怯えぬとはな。たくましいやつよ。
抜いてみろよ。
殿下の宝刀。
Whip it out, girl.
バッサリ決まって、今度こそ俺を屈服できるかもしれねえぜ。
面白い。こうでなくてはな。
Agitator. Challenge her. Drive her into a corner to make her speak in red. Of course, her red's always wiping out my only rays of hope. But don't be afraid of that. On this island to overcome with falsehoods and illusions, the only thing I can trust is the information she speaks in red. It's my only way across the chasm of hell. It's a single tightrope.Her merciless blood-red blade is the only way I could survive. This isn't just walking on a tightrope. It's like literally walking on the edge of a blade. Of course, I'm afraid. Because my victory condition is the denial of witches. Then, to use her contrapositive logic, the culprit must be human.But I didn't want to search for a culprit among the 18. That's what made me stick to a weak position, since I had to claim both that it couldn't be a witch and that it couldn't be one of the 18. Last time I was unable to understand that, so that's where she hit me, leaving me tattered and defeated. And crawling around like a fucking slave. But that's okay. Let her hit me.Let her attack. No problem. Someone said it once in an old sword fighting movie that a good fortress has one and only one intentionally weak point. The enemy would gather there, they would be lured there, and that would be where the actual battle took place. As long as I understood my weak points, and as long as she wanted to attack those weak points, it was as if I were luring her into and launching an attack there. Engage the distance between us with care, retreating step by step.Make them move forward. The more she recklessly flourished that red, the more chances I would get to strike back. Don't be afraid of the red. Keep her cornered so that she'll have no choice but to refute me with the red. No matter how oppressively she speaks in red, that's right, that red itself is the same as fresh blood leaking from her wounds. I mean, it's kind of true, actually. The more truth she says, the closer he is to the truth that can deny her existence.Even if it's fucking, you know, off the wall truth that doesn't really make sense. So you can't use that fucking willy-nilly all the time.
どうしたよ。まずはこの島に合計で何人いるのか。たくさんもないと、お前のカラスは俺に切り込めないぜ。
破れかぶれがこうもやりにくいとは。捨て身というやつはいつの時代も侮れんな。やはり金蔵の孫だ。追い詰められれば追い詰められるほどに不敵。
Ronove cleared his throat.
膠着しましたね。せっかくの紅茶も冷めてしまいますよ、お嬢様。
Ronove, who's supposed to be her ally, roguishly rushed her into making her next move. Beato probably thought she managed to smile back and appear confident, but she couldn't hide the sweat building up on her forehead. By now, she had completely lost the confident feeling she had allowed her to turn her nose up at her worthless opponent. Of course, he probably wouldn't be cornered by something like this. She's just being cautious. Till now, I've been inexperienced. I didn't know how to fight, and I wasn't strong enough to be her opponent.However, now that we've reached the third game, she realized that I'm starting to become more skilled, and she's grown more cautious, thinking every move over carefully. That's just fine, Beatrice. Sorry to keep you waiting. Are you happy now?
面白くなってきたぜ。
バトラー。
ラチが開かねえな。なら、ズバッと気持ちよく、いつものやつで行こうじゃ。
ほう、 いつものやならば頼もう。あれを聞かぬと、やはり始まった気がせぬわ。
First was mine.
行くぜ、ベアト。復唱要求。こいつを赤で言われちまったら、俺は18人の誰かを疑わざるを得ない。19人目の仕業にはもうできず、八方塞がりさ。あんな残酷な殺人を18人の誰にも起こせるもの。繰り返すぞ。復唱要求。この島には18人しかいない。
教室。
You can't say it. I'll tell you why, because if she says there's only 18 people on the island, that can mean one of a couple things. Basically, he has to suspect one of the people that are dressing up as Beatrice at that point. And that kind of like confirms that she's not a witch at that point. So, but she's not going to say that. Woo! I avoided what would have been the worst threat for me. If she repeated that, I'd be faced with those two worst choices of accepting that wish or suspecting one of the 18. Last time all over again. A Beato had proclaimed my ultimate and greatest weakness in red. She refused to repeat it, even though there was no reason for her not to strike, even though it was a weakness she should have been dueling at. She hadn't sliced me up with the red by using that move, which should have been as good as forking a rook and the king. She didn't fuck the rook, guys. There was a big sign of my advantage. That's right. Culprit isn't one of the 18. I won't suspect anybody. And since the culprit isn't a witch either, it means the 19th person exists on this island. And that's you! A person who has grandfather's mistress of 30 years, has been secretly living in a mansion, hidden in the forest for a long, long time. The human Beatrice.
So,
that's right.
お前は魔女なんかじゃない。この島に何十年も隠れ住んできた。ただの人間なんだ。
千年を経た無限の魔女のわらわをただの人間呼ばわりしたから。
For a while, Beatrice continued to laugh unpleasantly and gloatingly, or maybe spitefully.
Mika, 続けて復唱要求。この島には19人以上がいる。
Beatrice felt silent once more. Once again, she probably remained extremely cautious as long as confirming the number of humans on this island might give her some large disadvantage. Depending on the situation.Red has already become a foothold for my counterattacks. Now that we know this, it makes the red very risky for the witch. But if she couldn't repeat this, her Hempel's Raven wouldn't be effective. To break my devil's groove, she would need to settle the existence of a number of people outside the 18 in red. That's right, she couldn't break the existence of the 19th person unless she used red. I've closed Piazza in, giving her no choice but to speak in red. There really is a way to fight in this witch's game.
拒否してもいいんだぜ。お前が赤で言えないなら、この島の合計人数は18プラス。この X は初手で許すには相当でかい大駒だぜ。
Yeah, it is.
何しろ以後18人の誰にも全て18人以外の人間 X で説明可能になる。全員アリバイ系の密室を全て打ち破れる大駒だ。
It was just like how a chess bishop can cut a thin line through an enemy force, as long as there's a slight gap. It can only be effectively used on squares of the same color, but it was very good at controlling territory on the board. Looks like Beato also noticed her current plight. She couldn't just let such an important piece go, especially this close to the beginning of the game. If she pulled out her red treasured sword, it wouldn't be that difficult to save herself from this.But Beato was completely aware that I was suspecting it. She was afraid that a careless red tooth might end up strangling her own neck. Because in the first place, a witch is something that ought to be denied in red. Believe, don't doubt. Witches don't exist. Nothing like that couldn't exist in our world. Only exist in the valleys between toots. They have a fragile existence curled up in those cracks, frantically trying to protect themselves from the brutal winds of truth. They can only barely exist like a mirage by surviving on falsehoods and illusions. It's all true, you guys. In the other words, the red, which only witches can use, is the reality that might easily deny their very being. The more they brandish their red words, the more they begin to lose bit by bit that crack in truth inside which they can endure. That's what I was saying earlier, guys. The more that she uses red, the more she's killing herself, basically. You can't keep telling the truth and then start believing in magic all of a sudden, right? Because magic and truth are not diametrically linked at all. That's why they don't want to use the red words and carelessly lose that crack in truth, which is based on fuzzy information, or illusions in other words, because they understand that they're gradually being cornered. Of course that bastard would never admit it, because if she did, it'd be the same as admitting that she's something that can't exist in this world, like an imaginary number. Don't be afraid, stay strong. I know that she's the one who's really been pierced to the bone. After all, her red treasured sword can't be used without a lot of preparation.
どうしたよ、繰り返すぜ。この島には19人以上がいる。
拒否する
。 At the end of Beatrice's burning, she took a single brief breath and quietly announced her refusal. Thought she'd use it.Beato refused to speak in red even though it would cost a victory in the opening part of the game.
ということは今後
俺は18人以外の架空人物 X を
な好きにすわらわはそなたの副将を今はそれで十分拒否の理由はいやいずれすぐに分かる
もったいぶりやがってよ
あえて使わぬ赤もまたそなたは赤き宝刀と愉快な例えわらわも使おう宝刀は抜かぬうちが肌むしろ抜かぬことによって醸せる威風というものも
そうだなこいつはエレイプレッシャーなそれに副将を拒否される方が辛い場合もあるミスリードにはまって泳がされてるのか区別がつかないそういう意味ではなるほど、
ね、同じ突き落とす少しでも高いところに行かせてからに帰るまだ始まったばかりまだまだ
まだまだだね
この勝負は淡き勝利に今はよ
So far, episode 3, Battler 1, Beatrice 0. That'd be a good point to stop right there. 5.5 hours, we got a lot of stuff covered here. There's going to be a lot of backstory on Beatrice coming up here soon. Before we get into the killings. So the killings happen. So be prepared for... to learn a lot of shit about these characters in this episode. We're gonna learn a lot of shit about these characters and then some of them are gonna die right away. So, hope you're emotionally prepared for this. I'm not sure when my next stream will be. I'm gonna try to do it tomorrow. But basically, I won't be getting any more days off since we're now officially in summer. And it's gonna be fucking nonstop. Probably no days off schedules for me. From this point on, I usually get off at 6 p.m., 7 p.m., depending on the time that we stay open. So I could stream after that if I don't feel like shit, basically. So we'll see. I do want to continue this game, so one of the days that I'm off reasonably early, I'll jump back on this. It's going to be Probably not this week, though. If I'm being honest, it's gonna be another one of those long hiatuses, guys. Before you see me again. But I appreciate y'all stopping by. If you were larking. Dab's not here. Thanks for the follow. Leafa, thanks for the follow. Anybody that wants to watch my, like I said, my VODs are going to be on YouTube. They're going to be at Virgil Valentino. Check it out. I will have the end of episode 2 uploaded within 24 hours. So if you didn't get to see the start of this episode, episode 3, that will be uploaded to YouTube pretty soon. So check that out. And gear up for me to continue on with episode 3 in the future. And in the meantime, y'all, in the between time, I hope everybody be good to each other. And party on, dudes. Bye.